My name is Filipa Godoy, and I'm an associate professor and interim chair at the Department of Microbiology and Medical Zoology of the University of Puerto Rico School of Medicine. For me, microbiology is a way of answering questions and finding solutions to everyday problems. Microbes are around us, in us, on us, and they basically dictate our lives and our physiology. In my lab, we study microbiomes, most importantly, the evolution, transmission, and composition of the microbiota in relation to certain human diseases. We study oral and anogenital microbiomes for prevention of cervical cancer and anal cancers.
Once we got the tools to do a deep dive into the microbiome, the next big question was kind of, what does the microbiome do in the vagina? In fact, why does it look so different than the gut? I mean, if you think about it, the vaginal microbiome ends up being really fascinating. What people got interested is its role in, you know, inflammation, something referred to clinically as bacterial vaginosis. And that is basically a disruption of the microbiome. And we know that inflammation end up really causing cellular damage. And that cellular damage, anytime that occurs, that can cause a cancerous event. You get, you know, mutations. You can then, you know, go on just a whole carcinogenic environment. So people really want to begin to hook the picture together about HPV, inflammation, and microbial dysbiosis.
The big picture that I envision for my own research in 10 years probably is the development of probiotics, local probiotics that can be used for protection against the development of cancers. Also, to be able to manipulate the microbiome by co-culturing the different parts of the microbiome, bacteria, fungi, archaea, and be able to manipulate this in order to improve and to protect cells from, for example, HPV infections.
Right now, we're kind of left with making a clinical diagnosis of BV or bacterial vaginosis and treating that and making sure that we get back to a what we think we refer to as a normal, healthy environment. So it's very arcane the way we make that even diagnosis. I think the clinical hope is that we have these women who will be diagnosed with microbial dysbiosis in a much more sophisticated way.
I also envision that medical doctors will have a really nice training on microbiome, and I hope to be a tool for this. And I hope to be able to change current, you know, medical education to include microbiome research.
I think when it comes to the microbiome, there's so much more we're going to have to learn.
The topic of microbiome is actually a very easy, engaging tool, a very accessible educational tool to engage local community. And what's so fascinating about this is that you can really answer questions to everyday problems, to problems that Hispanics mostly suffer, and you can envision new solutions based on microbiome. I've received a lot of emails, you know, asking questions about what should I do? I have Crohn's disease, and should I be eating this? Or what solutions should I have to improve my gut health? So it's actually a very nice educational tool, and we should take the time to engage communities and also to empower our students to do this.
The one thing I would like people to know is how important it is to maintain a healthy lifestyle.
I would love people who are not scientists to know that research done on academic institutions can also be translational. So it can have a direct impact into the community that is being worked on.
I want people to know that not all bacteria are bad. In fact, many are essential for our health, and even more, they protect us against pathogens. So let's protect our microbiome.
My advice for other scientists and ASM members to be involved with local communities and to be able to translate their work is to take your time. I think service is a very important part of the scientific lifestyle that we should embrace. And more than ever, we should take the time to listen to others and to teach them about us, our science as well.